to give us an introduction to our first keynote speaker, Don Norman.
Thank you, Alex. So, in some conferences, Don Norman needs no introduction, but I would like to introduce him. It's really a distinct pleasure to be able to introduce Don as our first keynote speaker to RSD4 here. Don Norman is a director of the Design Lab at the University of California, San Diego, which is a multidisciplinary organization bringing modern design methods to the world. I'd recommend you look at their website to get an idea of how their approach to design thinking is moving forward, the academic program. Don is the co-founder and the principal of the user experience and usability consulting firm, the Nielsen Norman Group. And many of you may have subscribed to their newsletter over a decade and have known about them for over the years. Professor Norman is also an IDEO fellow and member of the Board of Trustees of the IIT's Institute of Design in Chicago. And formerly educated in electrical engineering and psychology, Dr. Norman began his career as an academic, working in psychology and cognitive science at UCSD. Joined Apple in the early 90s, and ended up in their leading the advanced technology group, and later worked for Hewlett-Packard before returning to university life at Northwestern in Chicago. Don helps companies make products enjoyable, understandable, and profitable. He has many books. You might know of Emotional Design, Living with Complexity and the Design of Everyday Things. Don's emphasis is on helping technology companies structure their product lines and business. So his major emphasis is on design strategy, how designers and design thinking can help drive both incremental and radical innovation within the company. So Don's talk today will explore whether and how human-centered design can help with complex socio-technical systems. So Don will examine some of the features of complex systems, present examples, speculate on possible approaches. And from my understanding of the way the talk will go, it will be highly interactive. So the show of hands, who's familiar with Don's books before coming? So you have a pretty good understanding of some of your work anyway in the audience. Who's attended one of Don's talks before? Well, that's pretty good. And they can be very interactive. So I understand Don's going to leave some time for, or is going, it will be interactive, there will be time for discussion. I want to add a personal note to the introduction, though, because I feel like I have to say I've been shadowing Don's career throughout my entire career, and learning from him that when you blaze new territory, you have to be willing to change your own theories that you've developed over the time. So if you've read from the series of books that Don has written over the years, he's explored, developed, and changed theories, methods, and even disciplines. So I studied from his first textbook with Peter Lindsay, the Human Information Processing, which was a classical cognitive psychology text in my very first cognitive psychology course as an undergraduate. I did my senior thesis kind of inspired by that book on consciousness and human information processing. Then as I got into my master's program, user-centered systems design emerged at the same time that I was in a master's of human factors and cognitive psychology at University of Dayton. I started attending the CHI conference very early in 1985, even, and Don was one of the kind of founders of human computer interaction as a discipline, and with a conference in its early years in the mid 80s. So, and then of course is Psychology of Everyday Things, later transformed to the Design of Everyday Things, has been influential, but even perhaps more so for me, The Invisible Computer, and then more recently, Living with Complexity have all been in sync with my own kind of restless exploration into, you know, the frontiers of design thinking and the kind of exploration of design into kind of more beyond technology and into its implications and meanings in the complex world that we live in. So Don's arc of contributions led to significant rethinking of other disciplines, and so I think he's, I'm very delighted he can be here today to be with us in our rethinking of systems thinking and design. So I'd like to have you warmly welcome Don Norman.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Peter. This is not for the audience. This is just for the TV, for the video camera?
For both.
Can you hear me? To let me start over. Yeah, what Peter didn't say is that I only work on problems that I don't understand. And once I understand it, well, then, yeah, I write a book about my understanding, and I move on to the next, which means that I often go into an area without knowing anything. In fact, I always go into an area without knowing anything, without understanding what I'm doing, and I say pretty stupid things along the way. Now, actually, I've come to believe that stupid things are often powerful things. Designers as a whole, traditional designers, are incredibly badly trained for the kinds of problems we're talking about today, because design is a craft. And if you go to design school, how many of you went to design schools, programs, four-year programs? You spend most of your time learning to draw, learning to two-dimensional drawing, three-dimensional drawing, learning to build things, learning about manufacturing, learning about materials. You don't learn anything about the world. You end up brilliant craftspeople, why we have so many brilliant, wonderful, delightful devices. And now you're working on reforming healthcare or the educational system. And it's not obvious where that helps. But designers sometimes do brilliant jobs. And the reason is, I believe, is that all the academic disciplines are analysis disciplines. You want to understand deeper and deeper the content. And so we have a lot of really expert people in academics, but they're divided into special disciplines. And unfortunately, that kind of specialization carries over into government and to industry. So the people are divided into their specialties. But designers are people who make things, who do things, who act upon the world. In fact, the design PhD is relatively rare. It's mostly, the terminal degree is mostly a master's degree. And what you do is make things. In order to create and make things, you have to cut across all those disciplines. But designers have no knowledge of those disciplines. They often don't even know they exist, let alone understand them. But what you have to do this work is quickly learn something about all the disciplines. And how do you learn? You ask stupid questions. And what's a stupid question? It's one where everybody says, oh, that's obvious. Good, now you've hit pay dirt. Because now you say, you would do the Japanese trick of the five whys. When someone gives you a problem to solve, you say, why is that the problem? And when they tell you, you say, well, why is that? And when they tell you, you say, why is that? And as soon as somebody says, because we've always done it that way, you know you've hit pay dirt. Because then you say, why do you always do it that way? And quite often, no one has any idea. And that's where you can make change. So that's what I do. I believe in bumbling through life. In preparation for this, and I'll give you a little history in a few seconds, I've been aided dramatically by, well, two people. Peter and John Flack. Is John in the audience? I haven't seen him yet. Not here. They've been sending me papers to read. Actually, I didn't know that I knew Peter. And so I was impressed with this very senior person who had written all these books and papers that I was now reading. So thank you. And along the way, I discovered how little I knew. In fact, here's a quote. Design thinking shows a robust history, maybe 20, maybe 50 years, depending on how you count. Yet the lack of scholarly follow-through in the field has left its intellectual development wanting. whereas system theories, you folks, were developed in keen awareness of the relative contributions from the scientific community, presentations of design thinking. You're aware of the contributions in the scientific community. But presentations of design thinking, perhaps due to its genesis in design traditions, rarely cite any precedent or theoretical influence. That is to say, in the scientific and academic community, we build on other people's works, and we publish, and we cite, and we try to replicate or build upon. In the design community, well, if you ever go to a design conference, here's what it's like, a practitioner's conference, say the IDSA, Industrial Design Society of America. I did this. And then I did this. And then I did this. Oh, and I also did this. There's nothing to learn from. I want them to say, I did this, and it flopped. And I had to rethink it. And here's what I thought about. And here's what happened. And here's why it failed. But you never hear that. We don't build. That quotation is from, well, Jones, 2014. In 2014, about a year ago, a bunch of us were in Shanghai. There's a new school of design and innovation being set up at Tongji University, and we are advisors. I'm now an honorary professor of Tongji University. And the group included people like Case DeBont from Hong Kong Polytech, before that from Delft. What's her name, sorry, who's now the dean at the School of Design at Delft. Peter Jan Stoppers, who's at Delft. Patrick Whitney, who's the dean at Institute of Design in Chicago. And of course, Lo, who is the dean of the School of Design and Innovation at Tongji. And I probably left out a couple people, but we sat around the table drinking late at night, week, day after day after day, and we said, you know, the problem with design education is what I just told you about. It's mostly craft education. Yet more and more designers are going into these complex problems, so why don't we train them differently? And so we invented this manifesto called Design X, completely unaware that anybody else had ever thought of this issue. And we published it in a few websites, and we got lots of people who were unaware of any work saying, how wonderful. And lots of people who were aware of the work saying, you stupid idiots, don't you know? I think in another quote from Peter, if I could find it. Peter has lovely quotes. Let me see if I can find it. Hubris and panacea might be chosen to characterize earlier attempts to understand complex social systems. Hubris fits because many are led to believe that design thinking is sufficient. Panacea because design thinking risks becoming a cure-all methodology. Again, Peter Jones. So I would like to plead, ladies and gentlemen, I plead guilty. We didn't know what we were talking about. We didn't know about the existence of things. But that's, to me, that's not a bad way to start. Okay, so I say silly things, and we say, hey, it's time that we brought design thinking to the world of complex problems. Well, in the last year, I've been learning a lot about complex problems, and it's due to a lot of you, actually. Many of you have been sending me papers to read and things to talk about. And so let me tell you where we stand today. First of all, we do stand on our original premise that designers are not well trained to deal with the kinds of problems we have today. And I think we really should change the educational system of designers. In my opinion, the best designers are often those who are not trained in design in their undergraduate years, but that pick it up later, because they get a broader training that way. And the second best is design schools within large universities, as opposed to standalone design schools of art and architecture, where you're required at most universities to have a broad education in the first few years. Especially true in the United States, the first 2 years tend to be general education, and the last 2 years, your specialty. The university, this is nice, but it's in part because the United States knows its high school education is so deficient, it has to provide the general education in the university. But nonetheless, I still believe we need to change it, but the question is how? So how could we change design education to make a difference? Well, let me now stop and say what makes what we call a design X problem and what you will be calling complex socio-technical problems. Well, in preparing for this, I spent a lot of time preparing for this, given that I didn't know anything, I had to worry about it. So I worked also with Peter Jan Stoppers from Delft. And as I put my notes together and I would pass it back and forth to him, I decided he's a co-author. So this is a jointly authored paper. We said, you know, there are about three characteristics of these complex problems. And then we said four. And then it was up to five. And then 2 days ago, it was eight. And after last night's dinner, I made it nine. So what are they? It's a system is composed. Now, a lot of these will sound like, well, yeah, duh, isn't this what the system writer has been writing about? But OK, but here's what we discovered by ourselves. First of all, you got lots of elements, and they're not independent of one another. Second, you have nonlinear causal relations. It's a feedback system. Third, there are long and unpredictable latencies. So when you do something, the results, you may never know the results, or you may know the results a year later. There are multiple disciplines and perspectives and frameworks. And even people who are collaborating can cause trouble, like when I say, room A is to the right. Oh, from your perspective, it's to the left. And so it's very difficult often to detect that people are talking from different frameworks, from different points of view. There are multiple incompatible constraints. Now, that's not unusual for designers, except that usually designers work in the small, simple products, simple services. And so the number of incompatible constraints is relatively, well, constrained. Not so in these large systems. There are dynamically changing operating characteristics. That is, the systems change. And with large systems, it takes years to make a difference. And usually by the time you're finished, the system is no longer the one that you started with. It's been changed. The people have changed their minds. The policies have changed. The technologies have changed. The problems have changed. The eighth one is people. Because a person is a complex socio-technical system, and a group of people is an even more complex one. And all these socio-technical peoples, all these social-technical systems, well, the word social, socio, is that there's involved people and institutions, governments and groups, which dramatically adds to the complexity. And this morning, I added nine, principle nine, which is that, well, if I look around the room, I kind of see it. We have these complex systems with loops. And like the chart on the far, your far right, the front far right, which is all these lines and things going in all directions. But the way we want to analyze it is like the chart over there, which is a linear sequence of operation. And this happened, we were discussing some problem last night at dinner, which is a complex socio-technical problem, or what it was, about visitors to the national parks in Canada. And there's one park, was it Alberta, where all over it's decreasing, but in Alberta it's increasing. And so Peter Jones, sophisticated systems thinker, says, why? What's the reason? As if there would be a single, simple, causal, linear thinking reason. We all fall prey to this. The human mind looks for causality. We find causal relations where there are none, but we try to simplify the world. We try to divide complex problems into fairly simple modules that are relatively independent of the others. We don't like these feedback systems because they're difficult to understand. We want simple linear causal relations with simple systems that we can grasp in our minds. And that's just the way we are. And I'll come back to that towards the end. Now, engineering designers have the privilege of working with technical systems, which are very, very complex, but you can make some sense of it. So Nam Suh has developed a system which he calls axiomatic design. It's somewhat controversial in engineering circles, but let me just accept it for the moment, because axiom one of his axiomatic system is basically components must be independent of each other. Because it's a really neat axiom, because if you could make all the parts of your system independent of each other, you could just work on that part and solve it and optimize it. But when there's dependency, you can't do that. So he said they should be, axiom one is they should be independent. And if that's not possible, even in engineering systems isn't, it should be one-way dependence. That is to say, A could impact B, even indirectly. But it should never be the case that B can then impact A indirectly. Now, that's usually completely impossible in these complex systems we look at. But I like those axioms, even though impossible, because the closer you can develop a system that has those properties, the better one can analyze it and make a difference. So, the real difference, I think, between what is done in traditional engineering design and what we do is, well, it's what Checklin has been calling soft systems. We are concerned about the people, okay? And we have a designer's perspective. Now, what does that do? So, yeah, we have human-centered design, but human-centered design came from the analysis of how we make products, trying to make simple products that people could understand, or simple systems, simple services that deliver something to people. And it was really a relatively simple problem. And human-centered design, which is, first of all, we do lots of observations, we then try to find the real issue that should be solved, and then we do an iterative observation, ideate, prototype, test, repeat, which is a hill climbing method. And hill climbing assumes a hill, and a fixed hill. Well, it's not obvious there's a simple problem to start with. It's not obvious that you can find what the fundamental issue is to be solved. It's not obvious that the landscape that we're dealing with is populated by a single hill, and if we can only get to any part on the hill, we just do some thing, and if it makes it better, good, we keep going. If it makes it worse, oh, let's try a different direction. That's hill climbing. But it's populated by a mountain range, and you never know whether you're on a small hill or a big hill, because it's populated by a mountain range that's invisible to us. So can this really help? It can only help if we have linear decomposable systems with simple causal relations. And that's something we don't have. So here's this morning's paper. Deficit, $6 billion. But there's a simple solution, taxes. Alberta finance minister promises to bring the budget into balance by 2018-19 and get the province off the roller coaster once and for all. Sure. But these are one of those systems with long latencies. Anybody who understands control theory, and hey, I was once an electrical engineer, and I even knew Norbert Wiener, for God's sakes. That's how old I am. Knows that what happens in control theory with long latencies is oscillations. So quite often a system with negative feedback that's designed for stability, if the feedback takes too long, it actually causes instability. And actually that's what control theorists do. They look very carefully at these situations. But long latencies and tax situations is long latency. And on top of that, it's a million different implications. When you raise the taxes, it's nice, it brings in more money, maybe. But as you know, as a feedback system, and taxing this causes that, causes depressed this, causes increased that, and who knows what the result is. It's probably impossible to predict. Or OPEC ready to talk fair pricing. If we only had fair pricing, we would solve the problems of the oil-producing exporting companies. Or AER gets tough, shuts down the Nexen pipeline because you're having too many accidents, deaths. We have to increase safety. Well, that's a good thing, but usually it isn't quite that simple. Because the usually way that we do safety is we try to find the person responsible and blame the person and punish them or retrain them. And that's not why we have accidents. It's not for human error. We have human error because we design things to cause human error, which is really neat because then we can blame somebody. So, even this morning's paper is filled with things. So how do we deal with those? And the answer is, well, I have three answers. Well, actually, I have one answer. The one answer is, I don't know. There's a wonderful set of papers by Lindblom, and I think it was John Flack who sent them to me, that I really recommend to you. Lindblom is a very well-known in his area. That's the problem. We have so many disciplines that being well-known in one discipline means you're unknown in the other. But he has a set of two papers called Muddling Through. One paper and then one 20 years later said, 20 years later, still muddling through. And here's what muddling through is about. The world is too complex for us to sit and analyze the problem, as a lot of these posters try to do, and a lot of your work. I'm picking on the posters just because they're there and I read them this morning. But we try to analyze the problem and figure out how to approach it, and we have all these wonderful meetings where we bring the actors together and we do our best. But these are big, complex problems. Any solution to them is going to be big, expensive, and time-consuming. And those are really difficult to get through a legislature or to get through any funding agency. And in the process, it will be modified and changed and compromised. And it will take years to do. And so by the time you do it, everything is obsolete and things have changed dramatically. And so what Lindblom is saying, yes, do analyze the problem, try to understand it, but then just sort of sit around and say, well, here's an opportunity, do it. Here's one, let's do this. Do the little things that come up, because the little things, you're not going to have a big legislative committee coming to analyze why you want to do this. And you can do it quickly, and you can maybe see a result. And if it succeeds, good. You can go on to the next thing. And if it fails, well, it's a small thing, and so it's not a big thing, and you don't get called up before committees and investigated. It's a relatively small failure that has minimum impact. And I like that philosophy. In fact, I finally realized that's the philosophy I've used in leading my own life. So Peter says, I've gone through all these different disciplines. Actually, I don't consider that I've changed disciplines very much from when I was a nerd at MIT studying electrical engineering. It's just that I've applied this stuff to, psychology. Yeah, there are interesting things going on. I wonder how the mind works as an information processing organism. And when I asked that question, that was horrible. Nobody in psychology hardly ever would think that way. It was, look, my first job as a faculty member was at Harvard University. And I joined the psychology department. It was introduced to the faculty of the psychology department, and B.F. Skinner. How many of you remember B.F. Skinner? B.F. Skinner then, after I was introduced, he stood up and denounced me in my field. When he died, I was asked by a friend to write an obituary, and I did. And I said, he was the person who, in the 20th century, he set back the field of psychology more than any other person. Well, but that's kind of the way the world goes. We have strong opinions. He was a really intelligent person. He was actually a nice person, believe it or not. He just had very strong beliefs about what was appropriate to study in science and what wasn't appropriate. And those are what we face. In the best of situations, when these complex problems, we face people who are collaborative, who are intelligent, who understand the issues, but have a different point of view and different biases, and whose emphasis is different than ours, and that's what leads to the difficulty. Or not different from ours, different from the other groups. Because we, too, have subject to our own biases and our own opinions. And trying to reconcile this is extremely difficult when they are cooperative. But in many cases, there are hidden, implicit power struggles and biases. In companies, we have the fact that although everybody wants a company to succeed, actually, I want to succeed because in the next round of promotions, there's only going to be one person promoted, and I want it to be me, not you. Or when it comes time to the annual bonuses, my division is reinforced by profitability. And there's only a fixed bonus file. And so it's better for me to get the bonus than you. So if I'm a designer and I suddenly realize that, oh, I could completely redesign this and make it much easier to manufacture and service, but I go over my budget and over my schedule, but I do it anyway for it's good of the company, at bonus time, I get passed over and the manufacturing division gets a bonus. So that doesn't incentivize people to work together. And trying to run and organize a company with the right incentives is really difficult. When you say, oh, well, let's incentivize people by how much the company profits. No, if I'm a low-level engineer, I don't think that anything that I do, I'm just coding or building mechanical things, that's not going to impact the company's profits, not in any real way. And so I'm not incentivized to do a better job. But what works? And the answer is we don't know. We really don't know. So what is it that designers can add? Can we really make a difference? Well, I think at one level, we are a supplement and collaborator to other approaches. We can't do it alone. We have to build on others. So if we bring anything, it's not going to be by working alone. And for a lot of the problems that I discussed with Jess and David on our trip from the Calgary airport to here, I don't believe designers have a role at all. They sounded to me like political problems. That is, you do have to bring people together. They do have to try to understand it and so on. But it's not at all obvious why anything the designers bring to bear are helpful here. Again, because our methods were devised for simple problems, where the issues that were addressed were simple. It's what actually Von Potter has called design 1.0 and design 2.0. Design 1.0 being artifacts and communications, design 2.0 being products and services. And now when we get to more complex things, what he calls design 3.0 and 4.0 is organizational transformations and social transformations. We don't have a clue. We really don't. So what is it? See, design was developed with here's the six major principles of design, in my opinion, modern design. Linear, simple causal relationships, relatively few disciplines and perspectives, independence of elements, and stable operating characteristics. And then there's two more which are the same as the complex problems, namely mutually incompatible constraints, although in the design world, just a few of them, and people. So people is sort of the common. So I conclude that the main difference is the way we treat people. So I've been looking at the health system at the University of California, San Diego. Again, I'm muddling through, and the opportunity came up. So the kind of problems we are now working on are the kind of problems that people came to us and said, hey, can you help us with this? And one of them was automation, and I can talk about that, especially in the automobile. And in fact, I will talk about it. And the other one is healthcare, where I have about five different projects in healthcare. It's huge because the University of California, San Diego, has a huge medical system. Actually, San Diego is one of the world's centers of biotechnology research and hospital systems. And the major startups that we have are sporting equipment. Most of the golf manufacturers are there. And surfboards and recreation and medical devices. And telecommunications. There's a small company started by a friend that does telecommunications. You know, the kind of friend, I meet him. We were friends in the early days of the university. He tells me he's going to quit the university and start a company. And I say, with my great brilliance, why would you want to do that? Well, his company is called Qualcomm. So, so that's where our expertise is, so why not build on that? But let me tell you quickly as an aside about the problem with automation of the automobile. So I'm not going to talk about how we automate automobiles, and I'm not going to worry about the complex issue about how on earth it gets introduced into society. I think the technical problems will be solved in the next 5 years, maybe. But introducing it into the world's transportation system could easily either be impossible or take 30, 40 years. It's difficult, complex. But here's one of the problems of a social dynamical system. So I have this car, and it's programmed to be safe. And the Google car is a good example. It does that. But all the car manufacturers, by the way, can do it now. Every car manufacturer that I work with, BMW, Mercedes, Toyota, Ford, Nissan, they're all doing it, Tesla. The only thing is some are more cautious than others. Mercedes seems to be taking the lead, Mercedes and Tesla, bringing their systems out onto the road to be used today, and the others are hanging back. Not that their cars are different, but they're afraid to. But now we take a car, and it's coming through a traffic intersection. And well, we've observed this on our university campus. When it is time between classes, the students stream out, and the students own the streets. And so I've watched a car trapped for 3 to 4 minutes. It couldn't move because students kept running and running and running. We call it herd behavior. What's the safest way to cross the street with traffic? Get in the middle of other people. And people are rushing and running to catch up to the herd so they can then walk with the herd across the street. And the car couldn't move, and so it finally forced its way through. Now, forced its way through. When I know that car is programmed not to go through, I'll just walk. I don't care what traffic light says. I'll just walk. I know the cars won't hit me. The same is if I'm really in a rush and I'm driving, I have a manual car, I can just speed through a herd of automatic cars because I know they'll get out of my way. And so we're going to get real changes in behavior. And there are real issues, too, because right now they have to follow the traffic laws, but the traffic laws have to be violated in order to drive safely. We all know that. The police know that. But the cars won't dare do that, which means they're not safe. Someone characterized a Google car as driving like your grandmother. And actually, if you drive too carefully, you're dangerous. The other cars don't like it, and the other cars get annoyed when you don't move and don't move and don't move, and they finally will just go around you or do dangerous things. And the same with pedestrians, and the same with bicyclists, and the same with skateboarders, and so on. Those are real problems, and one of the problems is it's continually changing. And look at healthcare. So if we look at radiation oncology, people diagnosed with cancer, who it was decided that their treatment should be radiation. First of all, it can take like 2 or 3 months to do that diagnosis with 4 or 5 different disciplines involved, lots of communication difficulties. And then you get into radiation oncology, and I've counted 12 different medical disciplines involved in that. And trying to figure out the exact prescription. So you take an MRI, and you take a CT scan, and you have x-rays, and now you have to superimpose them, but they're taken by different divisions. And they're taken sometimes at several weeks apart, and they don't superimpose because, say, the brain or the organs of the body have shifted slightly, so they don't match up anymore. And now you have to figure out where the tumor is, and you have to figure out how to radiate it. And you have to, it's a big machine. It's a $4 to $5 million machine with a linear accelerator built in it that rotates around the body so that it's the classic puzzle that you must have all heard when you were children. How do you radiate without killing the good tissue? Well, you rotate the radiation so that around the center of the tumor, so the tumor gets all of it, but all the rest just gets a little bit of the radiation. And computing that is really complex. And then having the meeting to figure out whether you've prescribed properly is so complex, involving medical physicists and dosimetrists and therapists and oncologists. They can't even schedule the meetings, and they don't work well. It's a really hard problem. It's a hard technical problem. It's a hard medical problem. It's a hard social problem. And the main difference is that we, when we go and look at it, we do think about the people. They draw these wonderful flow charts that are like this. It's radiation oncology is the neatest of all the medical disciplines, because you very seldom have emergency patients. Physicians can come to work at 8 in the morning and leave at 5. Everything is scheduled. Everything is orderly. You know what you're going to do. And even so, it's complex. And you look at all these boxes and the feedback loops, and then you open a box, and it's another diagram with millions of components. But I asked one of the radiation, it was a resident, an oncology resident, and his job was to check that the prescription matched the patient. And I say, well, how did you do that? Because he has x-rays and MRIs and CT scans and the prescription and the patient history, and he has to make sure all these go together. And how do you know? And the answer is, I guess. And it occurred to me that when you draw these pictures, you have an arrow that says, here's this thing, and now we're going to here. What's inside the arrow? Turns out the arrow hides all of the communication that's necessary for a sufficient operation. You see this in shift turnover. The nurses finish one shift, and then the new nurses come in, and the diagram just says, you know, shift over, whoop, new shift. But you got to transfer all the information you got when you're very tired and you want to get home, and the new people are in, and they need to get to work, and the bells are ringing, and there's some emergency, and somebody calling for somebody. And that's where the problems come. It's in the people. So, I think I was invited to come here because I didn't know anything. And I've come actually to learn, and actually I'm really pleased you asked me to give this keynote, because in the process of preparing for the keynote, I've learned a tremendous amount. I've been reading and writing and thinking and studying and doing my jobs, but trying with a new framework. But there's one thing that's really bothered me. And that's, if we really don't understand this, how come the systems that we have are kind of working? So the medical system kind of works, and the political systems kind of work, and so on. So what is it about it? And I think it's because we don't create. We try hard not to create the systems that are unmanageable, because we are fundamentally, genetically, linear thinkers. We look for simple causal relations, and we look for small, manageable pieces, and we therefore create organizations like that. And we do create organizations that, as much as possible, don't interact with each other. Now, in many cases, they ought to, but I think that we've actually created situations kind of in our image, if you will. And the reason that maybe so many things, they don't work necessarily well, but they do muddle through. Here we go again. They muddle through kind of okay. We all end up with water and food and sewage, all in the industrialized nations. And because over the years, we've muddled through to make things that kind of work. And the reason that the developing nations have so much trouble is they haven't been doing this muddling, and now trying to solve the problem suddenly is really difficult, because we've taken centuries to muddle through to what we have. And so I think that's my model of how we're going to survive and how we're going to solve these complex socio-technical systems. We will muddle through. So that's my talk. But now it's your turn. My hope, I don't even know how much time we have left, but my hope was that I was going to sort of do this, and now I want to hear back from you, and then we'll have a conversation. And yes, I'll follow the rule. You ask me or say something, and I'll repeat it so everybody can hear it. Thank you. Here we go.
Peter? Yeah,
so my name is Peter Pennyfather from Toronto, and I have had the opportunity to see you talk when you were talking to the at the University of Toronto when you were talking to a group on user-centered design. And in both that case and in your talk, you talked a lot about the problem of working with people, and people are muddling through. So as an engineer, I'm wondering, how do you document the bundling through process? How do you create data that can be retrospectively explored and represented by designers? So how some groups are better at bundling through than others?
The question is basically about the nature of muddling through, and basically how do you make things better? I'm interpreting what you said, that because in order to make things better, we need some data. We need some measurements. One of the things I've been doing along the way is trying to understand. I'd like design to be a better, more rigorous. So this is an answer to the question, believe it or not. And I've been trying to look to see what it means to have a science in any field. There are levels, and it often starts off with simple levels. That is, it's observations. We name things. We categorize them. That's how biology started, right? Just naming the plants and the animals and then discovering there were some relationships and then trying to invent categorization schemes. And we then eventually develop models and measurement processes. The measurements can be very simple. They can be just names, or they can be ordinal scales, or we just line things up in some kind of ordering. But from what I could tell, most advances are made because of tools. We develop tools which allow us to measure and allow us to observe things that we didn't think. Now, the tools are a problem because the tools are, it's all the sensors that we have in the world, and a tool is kind of a sensor, have a problem is that they can only measure what they can measure. And there's a tendency for the scientific community to believe that what is measured is the thing, and the stuff that is not measurable is obviously not important. And that's a problem that we face when we talk about people. But I think as we move towards making a better science of design, we're going to have a bunch of levels. We're going to have the part that's artistic and intuitive. We have a lot of that now. And then we're going to have a part that's going to be case-based. Here's something we did that seemed to work. And then there's going to be evidence-based. Here's what we did, and here's what we measured beforehand, and here's what we measured afterwards, and there was an improvement on the dimensions we care about. And after evidence-based comes modeling, and there are various kinds of modeling. There are qualitative models and then more precise modeling, computer models, and mathematical models. And there are other alternatives, but it's sort of in that direction. And I would like to be able to move design so it covers the range. I think we always will have the intuitive, artistic component. And by the way, that's true even in engineering design today, too. We still have a tremendous amount of intuition in trying to decide what kind of a bridge shall we build and what structure shall we use. And once we decide that, then there are very precise ways of computing the structures. And that will go all the way down to, I think, the parts of design today, a lot of color, using color and graphics. There's a lot of good science behind it in interactive design, which is, for example, the Design of Everyday Things book. There are some fundamentally good principles from psychology that can be applied. Unfortunately, Apple has ignored those, and so Apple stuff gets prettier and prettier every day and more difficult to use, but that's a different story. But I think what we need, I don't know how to answer your question, what this is stumbling about, but it's an essential question. We have to devise better measuring methods because we have to measure what we think is important, because the only way of knowing that you're making improvements is to have something to compare.
Who has the microphone now? Who is second?
Oh, we have a microphone.
Oh, well, I thought it was already passed. So over here. Thank you.
Hi, Ann Pendleton Julian. I'm an architect. I work in the same field as you, but from architecture. Loved your talk, fascinated. I could go on, I'd love to have a conversation. But I actually have a really, really simple question. I've never heard someone make such a kind of concise and clear and complete definition of design X, or socio-technical problems. And you talked about 9 characteristics, but you gave us 8. I'm wondering if you could run through them again, because it's so good. No, seriously, it is. It was so well said, because I have to talk tomorrow morning and I want to refer to it. So I could have done this offline, but
I don't have to repeat this for you. Actually, could I ask our designated Twitter tweeter? Did you capture?
He only said it.
Well, it's possible, but if you give me an email address, I can mail you the draft of the paper. But which just this morning, I went to bed late last night, woke up early this morning, and I added it. But 1, non-independence of elements. 2, nonlinear causal relations. 3, long and unpredictable latencies. 4, multiple disciplines and perspectives. 5, mutually incompatible constraints. 6, multiple scale sizes. Oh, you're right, I didn't say that. And that's actually, in many ways, that's the level of abstraction issues that Rasmussen has talked about a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks. Jeff, you would stand at
that. Is that stand?
Well, it'll help.
Okay, sure.
I'm standing, why shouldn't you?
Hi, I'm Ella Benor. I was at IDEO for 13 years and now have gone out into the social world and other things. But as we muddle through this kind of system development, and as we go through the progression you talked about, from craft to modeling, do you feel that there are kind of key inquiries, or like what are there key sort of questions that drive that motion, that whether you're at that intuitive level or down to the modeling level, that kind of stick with us that whole way? What are the kind of questions that might drive us?
Well, that's another question to which I do not know the answer. I think that in most established fields, we use the techniques that are available. And so we use the numerical and the precise, especially it's often built into the tools nowadays, modern CAD tools, for example, do stress analyses and do other things. So we use what tools are available. And as a scientist trying to do this, what I try to find is the levers. That's why interaction design attracted me at first, I think, because, I have principles from psychology, which actually are from control theory in many cases, that I can apply to how do I design something that people can understand, where they know what is possible to do and they understand how to do it and they get some immediate feedback about what was done. And so, we just use the best tools we have. Or as a scientist, we develop where there's an opportunity. By the way, in science, the hard part is asking the right question. A sort of an unofficial mentor of mine when I first joined the faculty at Harvard was George von Beckesche, who studied the hearing. He studied the ear. And actually, they didn't know what to do with him at Harvard. He was in the basement, and he didn't have a teaching position. They wouldn't make him a professor, but he did brilliant work. And what he said was the hard part in science is asking the right question, that lots of people, if you read most journals, they're nonsense. They're people asking trivial questions, studying very carefully, and giving you trivial answers to the trivial questions. And the problem is you want to find a problem that's significant. Now, he liked to say that graduate students are good at this. They will find important problems. But the trouble with these important problems, you have no idea how to work on it. They're too big, too complex. And so what's really hard is to find a problem that is both important, but there's a place that you can make an advance. Now, I don't know what the secret of that is, but that's where I try to focus my efforts. Bekashi, by the way, went on to win the Nobel Prize. And suddenly Harvard said, oh, wait a minute. Yes, would you like to be a professor? Yeah.
Hello. Hi. Patrick Suen from Toronto. When we look up human-centered design, we have this approach. You kind of mentioned it earlier, observe, prototype, test. And then to make it nonlinear, you add iterate. But that was what you said as a hill climbing method. So if we're approaching these like mountains with fog and that type of problem, how would you change this human-centered design approach to fit into that type of problem?
Yeah, the iteration is not to address nonlinearity. The iteration is because we don't know enough to be able to analyze a problem, think of a solution, and say, there it is, it's correct. We have to actually try it out, because we're involved with people and we're involved with systems we don't fully understand, and it is hill climbing. So there are two answers I'll give. They're both related. The traditional way of solving the problem of local maxima is that you try to start in multiple places. Or you shake the system if you want a simulated annealing approach, dynamical systems for those of you who know that stuff. That in design, it's often said that we don't want you to come up with one solution. We want you to come up with, say, three different solutions. And if you do that and you try them all out, that's what's one possible way of trying to avoid the local hill. But the real answer is we don't know. And we really don't know. And here's a problem. I wrote a paper with Roberto Verganti, who's in the Politecnico in Milan. And we argued about just this. And we said that human-centered design is good for incremental improvements, incremental innovation. But in fact, because that's what it does. I make a product, and oh, it's got some little problems. I'll make it better, I'll make it better. But you may be in the wrong hill. And how do you know? How do you get to the right hill? And the answer is, we don't know. But I think it's even worse than that. There are no hills. They don't just exist. There aren't the hills there. When I first joined Apple Computer, they were about to release a new product. And I looked at that product and I said, oh, wow, that will revolutionize the world. I was very excited by it. It got released and it failed. Some people liked it, but basically it failed. So they did it a second time and it failed. And they did it a third time and it failed. And Apple said, okay, no more. So was I wrong? Was it a bad product? No, it was a great product. It was a camera. It didn't require film. Now, you may not even know what film is, some of you. But it was an early digital camera, and the problem was, here's the hill of film cameras, and film cameras were pretty high up, pretty near the top. And here's the quality of the digital camera. Now, is it because it's on a real mountain and you simply have to move up there? And that's what we said in our paper, but I now think that's wrong. It was low down because the hill didn't exist. And what you had to wait for was somebody to create the hill. So why did it fail? Well, first of all, it could only hold 8 pictures. Now, that's all the film could do, so that was okay. Second, you couldn't see the picture that you took it. Well, that's okay. No camera let you see the picture when you just took it. Third, what did you do with it? It wasn't of great quality. It was a pretty bad quality, the same quality of standard video, which I don't think anybody watches anymore. We watch high definition. It's the same quality of standard video, or a little bit less. But what did you do with it? It was really hard to get it out of the camera into your computer, and then it would fill up the memory of the computer. So you're supposed to send it to somebody. But the way we sent things is you took your telephone and you stuck it on these rubber cushions and you sent it 300 baud. You don't even know what baud means. 300 baud means 30 characters a second. Not 30,000, not 30 million, 30. It took forever. And so it took time for displays to get better, for the detectors to get better, for memory to get better, for the CPUs to get better, for inkjet printers to be invented. We didn't have them then, so you couldn't print out the picture easily. And for faster communication. The hill wasn't there. So what I'm doing is I'm saying the problem is not only hard, it's even harder than that. So the answer to your question, how do we know if we're on the right hill? There's no way that I can figure out. You don't know.
Okay, the microphone's over here. Introduce yourself and
Hi,
quick question.
Peter Nicholson, Foresight Design from Chicago. As a dropout from the institution on whose board he sits, isn't the, sort of building on what you just said, isn't the problem with design education the demand for it? The fact that we're at a systems design conference and there's only 100 people here where there should be thousands? Wouldn't design education be accelerated by greater demand? And number two, given the pressing issues we have, particularly with climate change, can we afford to muddle through? Do we need to be more strategic and aggressive?
There's a problem of one of the interesting things that we were introduced by, well, I don't know what your title was, not the minister, but someone from the government of Alberta, right?
That's right. Assistant deputy minister.
Deputy minister.
Assistant.
But let me say, I was impressed. Because we had someone from the government who, quite often, I go to a conference where we bring in the mayor, or we bring in people from the government, or we bring in people from the, you know, the national government, and they say the very nice things about, oh, I'm very well pleased to welcome you, and then they leave. But here we had somebody who actually has been taking part in the activities and understood what we're doing. And the introduction was really nice because it was relevant and said things. I thought it was a great preamble to my talk. That is rare. But unless we get, look, the problem with these conferences is we mainly talk to ourselves. And if we want to have an impact, we can't just talk to ourselves. We have to talk to the people that we're trying to help. And designers always have these meetings in which they complain that executives don't listen to them, but there are no executives in the meetings. And they themselves don't become executives. If you want to have an impact as a designer, you have to get promoted. So I was a vice president, and that helped at Apple, although Apple was a company that already kind of understood the value here. A friend of mine just became chief design officer of SAP, and let me tell you, SAP products have dramatically changed, so much so that when his people go out and show their customers, the customers say, but do you work for SAP? Chief design officers, executives, in this case, strategic people, need to be in the positions of power, the kind of people you are trying to influence. You have to become the kind of person that we are trying to influence, so you begin to understand the complexity. And until that happens, I don't think we're going to make much progress. Academics, and a lot of you are practitioners, but you're still acting like academics. Academics talk to themselves. They publish in academic journals, which are read by academic journals, or the practitioners are practice and they publish in their own journals or conference proceedings which are read by the people who go to the conferences. No, we have to break out of that. We have to realize we're part of the system, system thinking. We have to move up the chain to talk to the people we care about. I talk to designers, I say, who is your user? And they say, oh, the people who buy the product, you know, take the picture and do it. No. And if you work for a company, your user is the boss of your boss, and it's your job, or if you're in a private consultancy, your user is the person who hired you. And you should think of your job as not just to solve the problem I asked you to solve, but to get them promoted. You have to think about it from what they care about. And they don't care about the fact, oh, I made it so that it was a little bit less confusing to the user. They care about sales went up and the profits of my division went up. So until we change that mindset, we're not going to be very effective.
Okay. Thank you. I think we're going to need to bring the questions and discussion to a close now at the hour. I know there are other burning questions in the room. I have some as well myself. Don's going to be available for for the next few days, as are the other keynotes. So, I'd like to thank Don. Thank you for your keynote opening the conference today. And we have a gift and an acknowledgement for you, provided by Sharon.
Hi, Don. Thank you very much for opening the conference in such a startling way. I can't remember the last time, if ever, I heard somebody start a conference by saying, we don't know, and we're going to muddle through. So thank you very much. We have a couple of honorarium pieces. One is so that you remember the location of this conference, the first in Canada. One is a book from the government of Alberta on Alberta images. And
thank
so
you.
That you can remember and understand that there's more of Alberta than is behind the mountains. And a check for you. And the other
thank
piece.
You.
And the other piece is Innovation Platform is a social enterprise focused on flourishing societies. And we're pleased to use the have the opportunity to borrow the Inukshuk as a symbol that really perfectly symbolizes folks like you who are way showers. The Inukshuk are piles of rock that are used in the Canadian Arctic. First Nations provide them as a way to symbolize for those who come after the best road to follow. And so you as a way shower are one of the people in this world of systemic design that are taking the path and leaving a trail for others to follow.
Thank you, Sharon. Thank you all, and I'll see you all for the next few days.